Oh, here it is.
Yeah, what kind of density are they talking about? Two units?
Four units.
Four units all around.
Okay.
Oh, I see. Oh, right along the road?
No. It's a long, thin parcel.
Oh, okay.
So they're stacked up, one behind the other, like a train.
I see.
Okay, and Noreen did send me this at 1:30, so it was before I moved here. I just hadn't had a chance to read it.
No, that's all right.
Thank you.
Of course.
So, yeah, just in there.
How long did it take you to drive up to your place in Maine?
Takes about an hour and a little less than an hour and a half to get to Portland.
Oh, okay.
And then it's a 15-minute ferry ride.
Oh, okay. I have a cousin who lives up there in Cambridge.
Yeah, that's a lot longer. That's like 5 hours.
It's like forever.
Yeah.
I never did that. I tried, but eventually turned back.
Here's Roy.
We've got one for all of these. That's great. Hey, Roy.
Yes, there's only, look at it. It's nice and crisp.
It matches my book. Did I tell you I somehow got on the CC list for the restaurant downtown?
No.
In Weston, in Wellesley Bay.
Right.
I think I get like 5 years.
Oh, really?
Digest. Oh, it's great, yeah. So I created a filter with like anybody's name, and like I put it all in a folder, and I dare go to that folder about once a week, you know.
That stuff is blowing up my server. I mean, yeah. You know,
oh, you're on it too?
Yeah. Okay. I've forbidden to take anything off of it. You know, I can't delete any of the messages. They have to stay on there.
Oh, I see. It's a nice picture of town hall.
Oh yeah, that's my state house backdrop.
We went to the World Skating Championship, the figure skating championship.
Where were we?
In Boston.
Really?
Yeah, there was a garden. So that's what we went. We went for the pairs finals and the women's singles finals.
Really?
Yeah, it's beautiful. We had a nice week, almost all of our stuff. It's incredible. I didn't even know they were there. Somebody said, hey, we got these tickets. And then so ML said, which one do you want to go to? So I chose the pair. She said, I love the opportunity. I was like, there's only so much, you know. But it ended up, we stayed there from like 1 to 11 at night.
Really?
Yeah. I was like, wow. And we did have a break. We went for dinner, but not very far. But it was just, I mean, those girls were just amazing. They really are.
They're so young.
And they're just, oh,
my gosh.
Oh, God. You know, it's a four, depending, I think the pair is around 5 minutes, and then the single is 4 minutes and 30
seconds.
There's Steve.
Hey, Steve.
You can run the thousands of hours.
Let the fun begin.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
And then,
sorry.
Like,
it's
one
not a
little slip, you know, and then you bet on them.
Yeah.
Like, it's a little milliseconds.
It's unbelievable. Okay. Everyone's coming that's going to be coming, so we can open the meeting. Beginning with citizens' comments. I don't hear any. All right, hearing none. Why don't we've got a few minutes before the first camp hearing. Maybe we could just take care of reading the minutes.
All right, then.
You and I both said yes. No.
Thank you. Do these include Al's?
Thank you.
Revisions?
Yes. This is all revised.
You want to come in? No, I'm getting it.
Yes.
We have a, you know, when you feel like taking a stroll at lunchtime.
Yes.
Walk around the town green and measure the sidewalk.
Actually, I was walking the day we met down the hill. I noticed there were two women walking strollers side by side on the.
Right. Did you measure it?
I didn't measure it, but I thought about it that day. I should measure it.
Somehow they get plowed. How does it happen?
And I can assure you that the Church Street one is 4 feet.
Yeah.
Yeah,
well, the other thing is, if you want to take a little water walk, walk down the post road to St. Peter's Church, the brick church on the corner.
Okay.
Walk down that sidewalk. 3 feet.
3 feet
from the green down to about halfway down.
Six.
everybody done? And then I had one question, Sean. Case Kansas?
Yes.
But the minutes say an analysis was done on the turning radius to widen the school entrance by 14 inches.
Not true.
That's, I thought we talked about adjusting the width of the road at the turn in front of the recreation building.
Correct.
To accommodate school buses.
Correct.
Okay. I just wasn't sure I was right about that.
Yep, you're absolutely right.
Okay. So that needs to change.
Okay. So not to widen on the turning radius to widen the
roadway in front of the community center.
Fronting the community center. To widen the roadway fronting the community center. Okay. That is
some refer to it as the S curve.
Okay. Okay.
I have a couple of changes. On the first page, second paragraph under Winter Street,
mm-hmm.
on the first line, second sentence, fog describe a wooded area.
Yeah.
By the way, this isn't, since I wasn't here last time, the was it the Brown Street sidewalk that got voted down in town meeting, or is it now the Winter Street sidewalk?
Winter Street sidewalk was voted down, so this is coming back.
Well, what about the brown one that goes to the school?
I don't know what the status of that is.
So they're separate?
I think so.
Okay. And on the second page, second paragraph, I don't understand that sentence. Danforth pointed out that the area of the street that would be paved would make the street wider and hotter.
Sidewalks they were proposing would go from the stone wall to the curb. It's currently
mm-hmm.
so that the effective paved width would increase because the sidewalk and the street would be continuous.
And there's no curb.
There's a curb, but it would all be asphalt.
Yeah.
Oh.
Okay. Okay. And then same page, third paragraph under 25 Double Hill. Zacharias expressed concern with the wall and grading curved, lacked a natural shape.
Grading, yeah, should be grading curved.
Curve.
Mm-hmm.
And then I just have a question about, because I wasn't here last time, what these personal meetings are with you on a routine basis, the purpose of that.
Okay, so that is basically so that, you know, I can keep abreast of your folks' concerns. You know, we don't have a lot of time, obviously, during the meetings, and if it's not something on the agenda, you know, we can't really discuss it. So this is to basically get some regular time, some regular consideration that you could come and, you know, tell me this is what we want to do, and I can just kind of start making plans around that.
Sounds good.
So,
thank you.
Sure.
Okay.
I have two things. See, on page 123, this Flynn abstained based on not being active. I think we can stretch that sentence. I just want to make sure that you understood that. I think the minutes that we were approving there stated that I approved all minutes. While we were at the March 8th meeting, I approved minutes on meetings where I wasn't present. I just want to make sure you corrected those minutes from before. You understand what I'm saying?
Okay.
So I was at the March 8th meeting. I don't need to abstain from approving those minutes.
Mm-hmm.
But I requested a modification to those minutes.
Yeah. Okay.
You get it?
Yep.
You can just delete that sentence. And then I just need to let you know that those other minutes need modification. I was asking for that.
Gotcha.
And then the other thing is on the page having to do with the turnpike land freed up.
Mm-hmm.
It said will exceed 3 acres. I thought it was much more than 3 acres.
It is much more than 3 acres,
okay,
but I remember the question was, is it more than 3 acres?
Okay,
and the answer was, yes, it is, but
okay.
We're not sure exactly how much more.
Bigger than a bread box.
Yes.
Okay, got it.
Just have a quick edit on page 2, very first paragraph, last sentence. J Chattelbash said the goal is to avoid the amount of trees that is taken down.
Okay.
That be taken down.
Yeah, that are taken down.
Okay.
Our children is learning. Okay, I move that we accept the minutes from March 23, 2016 as amended.
A second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All aye?
Thank you.
Oh, you were here, you're right. So, three in favor. Good. Okay. And we can go on to the first hearing. The Gulin, is that the correct pronunciation? Gulin Camp at Regis College? Is anybody here to present that? No? Nobody's here to present it?
Okay.
The applicant has to make the presentation.
Yeah, and has to make the presentation. I don't know why they're not here.
Okay.
Unless, yeah, Ron might be right. They may be upstairs or something.
Maybe they're already just gone.
Yeah.
Do you know when they were planning to start the camp?
The camp is, we have it there, 16th
of what?
July.
Of July?
Yeah.
Okay, so if we continue this, we still have time?
Yeah.
Okay.
Now I know where to be found.
Yeah, it's quiet as a tomb.
Okay.
Just out of curiosity, are you representing the, you're representing T-Mobile?
T-Mobile and Regis College.
You are. And is anybody here yet to represent Longfellow Camp at the high school? Okay, good. So, you're actually, are you presenting both of the T-Mobile presentations?
Just the first one.
Just the first one.
Is that it? Because the gentleman knows.
You're doing the other one.
They split.
Okay, so, good. We have attendees for every other meeting. Good.
And we have our own zoning.
Yeah, isn't that amazing?
That's just absolutely amazing.
The last updated version was 2012.
Yes.
Yes. Oh, this finally includes.
Yes.
Did you edit something?
Unbelievable.
Did he edit something?
No, this is just
a clean printout.
Yes,
a clean print.
There is our
just out of curiosity, is Lot Clarence in here?
That's what I was.
I don't know.
Okay,
it should be.
I hope so.
So do you want to just continue this to the next meeting?
If there's time.
Yeah.
You know, I think we'll have to continue it to the next meeting when we're not totally booked up.
We shouldn't be booked up at the next meeting. We're only planning to take on the 140B project now, so I think we have time to.
Okay, so we're going to continue to March, to April the 20th.
To April 20th, yeah.
Yeah. At what time?
April 20th at. I would say we should take this on at 7:30, 7:40, probably somewhere around 8:20.
8:20,
yeah.
We'll continue to 8:20 on April the 20th.
Would it be in the head?
I
on-site alteration work which requires or will require a stormwater permit. Any zoning or other land development permit or approval shall be performed on any property until such permit or approval is obtained, including any one of the following. We were wondering whether lot clearance was included.
Okay, good.
Objections. I don't see any reason why we couldn't start the T-Mobile hearing a few minutes early. It's 5 of 8. And let these guys go about their evening. So I'll open the hearing for T-Mobile modifying the conditions of approval at Regis College. Who's making the presentation? You two gentlemen?
Yes.
Could you give us your names, please?
Certainly.
And we've given this about 20 minutes
okay.
for the presentation. Before we start, I'm Al Adelot. I'm the chairman of the planning board, and the other members are...
Steve,
Roy Chabalash.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Page, my name is Ed Parry. P-A-R-E, I'm attorney at Brown Rudnick in Boston. They represent T-Mobile. With me is Eric Callahan, who does the site acquisition work for T-Mobile on this particular site. So T-Mobile currently is located on College Hall at Regis College. We're one of the, we call them faux chimneys, we can call them faux enclosures, whatever they are, but they look like chimneys on top of the roof. AT&T currently has, currently has two of those enclosures, and just to show you what we're doing, and there were some questions about technology. In the top two photos of the existing faux chimneys, the rectangular items are the antennas that are inside, two on the left in that enclosure, one on the right. And what T-Mobile's planning to do is to add one additional antenna, which provides high-speed data service, 4G, the next generation of high-speed data. And those are represented by the shaded antennas. So they'll be tucked one in behind so we can keep the size of the enclosure minimized. And in the other sector, we'll add a one antenna for a total of two. So the goal, as you can see, is that we're trying to get coverage out of circular patterns. So we've got a 360-degree array. So we have the three sectors, which will basically cover the three areas around the building. So we can go to the elevation next. So T-Mobile currently has two of these enclosures. You'll see where all the arrows sort of point to. Its equipment is kind of near that penthouse in the center of the roof. So the enclosure way over to the right is one that we'll be replacing, and one way over to the left will be the second. There are other features that are similar. As a matter of fact, a couple of the enclosures, the actual, whatever they are, vent pipes, are located nearby, and we designed them so that they would be similar. Maybe to go to the roof plan, which is probably the first page. Yep, so on the left-hand side here, to give you a sense of where we are, up at the top, you'll see the dark area is the enclosure area that we're proposing. It'll replace the existing. And then you see all of those cable trays and the cables that run from the antennas over to our equipment. If you look down to where the building kind of comes out, which is the face of the hall, you'll see the other square is the enclosure that we're proposing to replace there. So the two enclosures, top and center, the cables all running the existing cable trays, and we have some of our equipment on the penthouse, as I mentioned. Do you have the photo sims?
Yep.
So we took some photographs of existing conditions. What's interesting here, can we go back to that first one just to get a sense? So the star, the yellow star in the middle is the location of the building itself where the antennas will be going, the enclosures will be going with the antennas inside. The yellow line is a 500-foot radius, so unlike a lot of these facilities, we're actually not anywhere near public roads, et cetera. So you know, we're in, back on the campus and in the sort of center of the roof of the building. So we could flip through. So we have various existing photos, and then we do a simulation as to what we expect it to look like. So this is existing. So you'll see T-Mobile is way up front here with that enclosure. The other two are either other antenna, other carriers, or enclosures for something else. If we go to the next, that's what we're proposing to do. So we're going to add 18 inches to the enclosure. We're currently 30 inches by 30 inches. To fit the antennas, we need to go to 48 by 48. What we did was to keep the height similar. We're using a 9-foot enclosure, and then we put a 1-foot cap on it, so we have the same sort of design. So it gets a little bit wider, but the height will remain the same. And we could flip through these. They're just sequence of a different look. That's a different, that's also from the south looking back towards the school. So the first one was sort of south, looking southwest. This is looking almost due south. That would be the front of the building. This is existing conditions now, and that's the proposed change. And that's looking from the northeast of the building. That's existing, that would be existing, then proposed, it gets larger. That's again from the northeast. So those are the four different locations that we shot photos from and then superimposed digitally the changes. So the antennas are completely enclosed, they're completely hidden, and we took these photos, they're pretty up close, but I think from the street level or you know, anywhere outside of the campus, there's probably not going to be the same issue. In your packets, we provided statements from our radio frequency engineer that the facility complies with all emission standards, it's not going to generate any noise, it's non-moving parts. There's an emission study in there. That's the extent of our materials, application, and presentation. I'd be happy to answer questions if there are any.
So what you're proposing is, I take it, an increase in the RF generation, but still under the guidelines.
Well below, yes. These are all low power. The only, from a safety perspective, standing in front of the antenna is where we keep folks away. So if you've seen any of these, you'll see signage around that says there are RF emissions in the area. In this instance, it's a roof. To go up to the roof, we need to be escorted by security. So only folks who know what they're doing, workers, would go up into the area. As far as the emissions, the FCC measures them 6 feet at ground level that you can't access, and then they would be well below the standard. And you have that information in your packet.
What about the people that live right below them, or the offices?
Well, that's a good question. The actually, the power of the emissions that comes out of the antenna is pointed at the horizon, so it operates along the flashlight. Right. Mm-hmm. So actually, if you're right underneath it, you probably get no exposure whatsoever. But the strongest would be directly in front of the antenna at the midpoint of the antenna. So you'll see in all of our materials, we have center line calculations. You wouldn't want to be standing directly in front of the antenna, 2 feet away, right in the center of it. But as soon as you get away from it, it dissipates, and the signal gets eaten up everything it hits. So the idea is we get above trees, we try to stay away from buildings, get above buildings. So the signal itself, the power would be pointed towards the horizon, not to people above.
And are there two of those proposed?
There are. So we have one on the SIE. There's one kind of on the north. I'd probably go to the roof plane.
That one. No, it's that one. I mean, this was showing.
Right, so you have one. We were showing that one in the middle here. Can I just...
this one?
Yes.
That one.
So we're just looking at that one, and then the other one is to the north side of the building. We did see both of them. But those are the two.
Good. Questions?
No?
All right, what's the right?
I assume Regis is approved.
Yes, actually, I provided the letter of authorization from the school.
Good.
allowed us. We have an agreement with them, and they did consent to the plan.
In our decision, is there a requirement for renewal?
Renewal is a requirement of the bylaw, but it wouldn't hurt to repeat it in the decision.
I don't know if we had it. We often put the renewal requirement in the decisions. I just don't remember whether we had that in this one or not.
Because the nature of it's a special permit.
Yeah.
You did have one, and I'd suggest you roll that forward to so that we do get into the limit. But there was.
When was it up? Do you remember?
I'm going to say it's at the end of this year. I thought it was 5 years.
Yeah, this,
and we were 2011.
Yeah, this one was 5 years. Verizon actually did their renewal for these particular facilities.
They did.
Yeah.
We're not up for renewal yet on this, but it's not. I don't think it's very far.
Yeah. So might as well roll that into this.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I would count this as basically their renewal from today. Or from 5 years.
Yep. Then you won't have to come back next year or whatever it is, and just do that.
Not that it's not enjoyable.
Yeah.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Yeah.
Anyone has?
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
I got here late. Sorry.
Could you just identify yourself?
My name is Bob Acquion. I live on Chestnut Street, right like a quarter mile from the Regis building where this antenna will be. So my question is, I know we live right now in a very low cell phone coverage area, which I like because I don't like Wi-Fi. Anyway, I'm an electrical engineer. That's my background. I know about RF radiation. And my question is, I read some of the report, and I see that it's, you know, well under the federal guideline and all that. That's well and good. However, what I did not see in any of the reports was what is the absolute level that would be expected in like microwatts per square meter or microwatts per square centimeter for a typical resident on Chestnut Street or for the students at Regis College.
Yep.
Let me just add one more thing. Right now, the baseline level at my house is, depending on which meter you use, 1 meter detects peak readings better than another at 2 meters. But on the 1 meter that's good at detecting peak, I see 3 to 4 microwatts per meter squared at my house. That's pretty much the baseline. You can, basically you're just barely detecting whatever's going on at that antenna right now. And what I don't understand is there going to be like a major upgrade to that power or just a slight upgrade? Like, what would I expect?
Yeah, it would be a slight upgrade because we're not adding a tremendous amount, we're adding 700 frequency. The power will be relatively the same, so it's not a great additive. As a matter of fact, for the general population exposure, which you probably know better than I, if we add more than 5% of the maximum, then we have to mitigate, and we're not anywhere close. For the occupational, for people, as I was explaining to the board, for the people that actually access the roof, there are concerns, which is why we post signs, et cetera, so that they don't exceed the standards. It will, you know, comply with the standards. If once it's installed, you have any issues, I can give you my card. I'd be happy to address any concerns you have, but it will certainly be low.
When you said 5%,
5% of the maximum, if we exceed the maximum by.
You mean the FCC maximum?
Correct. But no. If we exceed 5% of the maximum, then the carriers have to work together, because one thing we don't know is. Because the carriers are located, I believe Verizon's on this roof. So if we came in and we're going to exceed the maximum, we're going to exceed 5% of the maximum for the general population, then we would have to do mitigations. And we're not doing that.
I understand. But based on where we are right now, if I'm reading 3 to 4 microwatts per meter squared in my house, what will I read after the new antennas are put in, just roughly?
Yeah, I have no idea. Once they're put in, we wouldn't know until they're put in. I mean, we wouldn't know in your house. It would be a hypothetical calculation at best. So I couldn't tell you what it would be until you get the antennas up and operating.
Well, the report that I read, and it admittedly was an early report early in the year, but it goes through in great detail and talks about percentage of the FCC maximum and where the existing antennas are and where the antennas would be after the proposed new antennas are in place, and it lists a percent that is like, you know, it goes from like 2.7% to 3% or something like that. But that's a relative number. What does that extra 0.5% mean in absolute terms?
That I don't know. I, as I said, once it's up and operational,
Well, let me ask you a different way.
Yeah.
What is the intent of the new antennas? Is this to make a better cell phone coverage, or is it to expand some of the local? I understand Regis is, those towers are used for more local usage at this point.
Can you put up the second of the photos in?
Yep.
So this one? Yeah, this one comes good. I think that's good. So, I don't know if you saw this when we went through, but the star is the location of the, that's the location of the building we're going on the north end, and pretty much where that star is.
Right.
Or we're adding to it. So, coverage-wise, the campus, directly below the antennas, they probably won't get much in coverage, in additional coverage. It's going to be more high-speed data.
High-speed data for the general public? Or
for the general public, for anybody who has a T-Mobile phone.
Okay.
So when you say the general public, you'd have to be a T-Mobile customer to gain the benefit of this. So the yellow line's a 500-foot radius, so we would expect to get, you know, very good coverage in that area and beyond. So, I don't know, would you say you're about 3/4 of a mile?
No, 1/4.
1/4?
As
if you're a T-Mobile customer, we'd expect you to do well at 1/4 mile. But once we get mile, mile and a half, depending on the terrain and the foliage, I see some trees, then we're gonna get.
So to back to my original question, is this something that the capability isn't really there now and you're adding like a total new increase in power to something that doesn't exist?
No, we do data now, it's just not as fast. And this
I understand the last time we heard one of these, and I'm afraid, it had less to do with more power, it had to do with more channels so they could multiplex. If you come across with more bandwidth. So he's asking you the question, is it more power or is it more channels? Or both, or do you know?
I don't know. Okay. I would say it's not more power because we're not increasing, it's not significantly more power because we're not increasing the power levels significantly. That I do know. The difference between the channels and the power, I couldn't tell you.
Yeah. I mean, I'm going to find out after it happens, but at that point, there's, you know, it'll be a done deal.
Well, but it's not, the point is, it's not too late. There are, I think you'll find that it's minimal. It'll increase minimally, but if there is a problem, then you report to this board or actually to the FCC.
Well,
this board's, well,
the problem is a relative term.
We have to show that we're going to comply.
I know.
And we're going to comply.
If you're a chicken in a microwave, you're concerned about the FCC limits, but if you're a person who lives in a rural neighborhood who's never been exposed to Wi-Fi or cellular emissions in any significant way in their lifetime, and all of a sudden a new tower's going up, you'd like to know, well, so far I've been lucky. I've been very low exposure, 3 to 4 microwatts per meter squared background level. That's good. That actually is one of the reasons why we moved to where we moved to. And now I understand civilization is changing and things are coming online and all that stuff. But there are still some people like me who prefer to kind of stay on the edge. And I just want to know, am I still going to be
on the edge?
Or am I going to be right in the middle of it, you know, like, and I just wanted a simple answer to that question. I don't really understand.
And I can tell you, until the antenna's up and operating, I can't tell you how.
Even just background, my guess is that if you give them a spec sheet on the old unit and the new unit, he'd be able to do some criticism.
If you're an engineer, I can give you the materials, but I can't respond.
He's going to be able to look at it and do his own calculations, I believe.
Isn't it a function of distance anyway?
Yes, it is.
But okay. He's saying, what's the
difference? So, in other words, as long as you know what the output is and the distance, wouldn't that give you at least an idea?
Oh, yes. I can tell you everything you know.
Yeah, right.
I'm just trying to find out what the output power change is going to be over all the channels.
So, you can hand him the specs of the new units, then?
I will. Can you give me a contact with him? Mm-hmm.
Sure.
Do we have, are those specs in the report that you gave to the board?
I don't think so.
No.
They can't be. I'd be familiar with them if they were. So
yeah. Okay. Well, it'd be helpful for the board to also get a copy as well.
I agree.
You could send him a copy. Or actually, if you work through the planner, mm-hmm. if you send the specs to the planner, then you can make contact with each other, and we can forward the specs to you.
Okay.
Okay. A request, not a demand, but also to have the old specs versus the new specs, so we see the difference, if that's available.
This is on Tarling, right? Just so I can ask the right question.
Yeah, I think yes. That's our, gets the public.
Total power output.
And it's directed too, so it gets a little bit complicated, right?
Hopefully, correct.
All right. Then I don't know what level would concern you. You know, what absolute level would concern you. I think one of the issues for us in reviewing these applications is whether there's a violation in the requirements, the federal requirements for right. this kind of a facility. And so the issue might become whether we would be able to effectively address your concern if you had one based on the specifications that we got from the applicants. You said earlier, it may be if you're concerned about the outcome, the avenue for directing your concern might be through, I'm not sure it would be through this board, because I'm not sure what power we would have to deny the installation. It might be more through the FCC. I think that's what I heard.
There is actually a mechanism to go through the FCC. So if you're not satisfied with what's provided, then you can certainly lodge those complaints. I think you'll be plenty satisfied, but I would agree.
Yeah, all I'm asking for now is what the numbers are.
Exactly, which we'll be happy to provide.
Okay, good.
And I'll do it through the planner.
Great.
My email contact is on the town website if you want to look at it, but we're in town hall there.
Okay.
This, I don't know if you've been introduced to the new town planner. He's only been here for a couple of weeks. This is Imai Kalani Ayu. As he says, he's up on the website now, so you can
look
him up.
All right.
Great.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you.
Well, by the way, when are we going to review the draft decision modification?
Next meeting. Yeah.
Our next meeting is April the 20th, so we'll review the draft decision.
And just a question, in the past when we've approved these, how have we validated their claim that it falls within the guidelines?
Well,
Did we hire someone independently, or
we have an RF consultant.
Okay, gotcha.
David Maxson.
Just asking the question.
We could ask him to verify. Gotcha.
I think if you pick up the phone and say, here's perfect, here's where they are, here's what they're doing, you'll get the response I just provided this gentleman.
Yes.
Right. Good, thank you.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Right. So I think we're ready to discuss the Longfellow Day Camp at Regis. And also at Weston High School.
Correct.
These are two separate camps, or one camp operating in two facilities?
One camp operating in two facilities.
All right, so you're actually scheduled for 8:20 and 8:40 for
yes.
Regis and then for Weston High School.
Correct.
Is it possible to separate your presentation to the two facilities, or how do you
sure.
do that? Okay, so we'll start with Regis Bell.
Okay.
Thank you.
So basically, the Longfellow Club in Wayland run summer tennis camps. We've been running those for 43 years at the Wayland Ladies and Sunday. And we run a tournament training camp. And most of the clients for those ended up in the Newton, Brookline, Wellesley, Weston areas. So we've worked with Regis College to secure a permit from them. And they're willing to lease us their courts for our tournament training camp. So the tournament training camp will have anywhere between 24 and 30 kids at the most.
that will be coming there. It starts, they'll drop off between 8:30 and 9 in the morning. You know, pickup is at 4 p.m. We anticipate, typically when we've got a tournament camp, we've had it in either Natick or Sudbury for Wayland in the past. And typically we have a lot of clients that come from Concord and Bedford as well. They tend to drop at the Longfellow Club, and then we transport them to whatever site they are. So we're trying to make it convenient for parents. So, you know, when we say I have 30 kids, we're probably, and then there's some siblings that are always involved. So I'm anticipating around 20 cars, you know, coming through and coming through there. They'll come in and just the Regis and go on. They have a nice little circle there. You know, we have staff there that will get them out and get them going. And the same procedure will happen at 4 o'clock too. As people get picked up, we will, you know, take the transport to the people who need to be back to either Wayland or the native traffic club within the hub where it comes from.
These are all outdoor courts.
All outdoor courts.
If the weather is really lousy for 2 weeks?
Well, we have plans. We have the indoor courts at Natick, which again, we go there. We also have the indoor courts in Wayland, so 17 courts there. You know, our tournament camp kids are like, we try to keep them outdoors when they can. We also have recreational parts that we tend to keep indoors. It doesn't take up all the courts. An average week for us is about 125 kids for all of our camps. But they're not at Regis. They've got some indoors in Natick, we've got some indoors in Wayland. You know, we have some, you know, in Wayland High School we've used before. We've used training in high school before. You know, we've all been permitted and all that, you know, information. So we've been doing camps for 43 years. And, you know, we're trying to find it more convenient for our constituents as well. One of the things we got in our feedback in our survey. By the time the parents come from Newton and Brookline and Wellesley and go all the way out to Wayland to drop the kids off, you know, and get back on Route 20 and Route 30, I don't think I need to tell you guys about that drive too often, right? So that's what we're trying to do. So it's not a huge camp.
Sure.
You know, and we do that. If it rains, we go there. If we were to get, you know, a sudden thunderstorm, we're going to use college to work with. They use our indoor courts for their college team. You know, they really allow us if we get any kind of weird weather to go right up into the gym area there that we can use.
So you can use Regis's facilities for dressing and that sort of thing?
Well, they come dressed ready to go. But if we're to use it, yes, we can use their facilities.
But you could, but if they have to go to a bathroom, for example?
Yeah, they have, they, you know, we've got use of all that. Yes.
Okay. This is the first time you've applied for a permit?
Correct. I mean, we do run tournaments there in the summer, but they don't require a permit. We use their courts for that. We've had a relationship with them for a while.
What are the ages of the kids?
Ages of the kids are between 12 and 18. Because you probably have 6 to 8 staff depending upon the week.
And you said 24 or 30 kids sign up for the whole period, or?
By week, that would be the maximum. Our average is probably between 20 and 24. We have a couple of big weeks because there's some big tournaments and we may get an influx of kids.
It's not like somebody comes for just a week, they come for 10 weeks.
Right.
One kid will come.
Yeah, well, you know, one kid comes for, you know, kids typically in our tournament camp average about 4.5 weeks throughout the summer of coming because they're all playing tournaments. Our different age groups have bigger tournaments and we have kids that are trying to get into tournaments, so that's kind of how it works.
Just out of curiosity, how many tennis courts are there at Regis?
There's 6 tennis courts. 6 outdoor tennis courts. Yes. Well, they're brand new. So we brought them to their brand new athletic facility. They have the soccer field. If you know what the soccer field is, the courts are right over beside them.
What's the surface?
That's hard courts. It's not clay. But it's hard courts.
So that explains the camp size.
Yeah.
You you're limited by the number of courts you have.
Correct.
Six courts, you know, you can do 12 kids, or if
they're... Well, I mean, if we're trying to camp kids, it's not, like, it's not recreational. I don't want to put... our reputation is we have very low ratios. So, I mean, if we were to get 30, that would be a big week. That would be five per court. But these kids need to be training, need to be hitting the ball. Yeah. Recreational camp kind of spread out and do different things and put tape up and bump it over. You know, I could run a class in here, but I guess it's not optimal what we can do for one day in the rain. I mean, our average, I've been running camp there for 12 years. I got hired as a tennis director, camp director there 12 years ago. Our average rating, that's the question about rank, we average about 2.5 days where we have to live inside this summer. You know, if this, for example, where we've been at Wayland High School or Birmingham, if we get rain, then we a little bit of rain in the morning, we'll just have a delayed start. We do fitness, we do mental toughness, we do, we talk about equipment, but we get about 2.5 days where we just say we go indoors. Other than that, we may have a 45-minute late start.
Seems pretty straightforward, indeed. No impact.
How many instructors?
Six to eight, depending upon the week. Six if we have 30. We try to staff it 1 to 4. Sometimes we'll do our director, and then we have a couple of college kids that may work for us as well. That we make the ratio like 6.5, 1 to 4. We need that because it's a week of camp. We have high ranked players. And so we'll bring in a couple of extra college kids as counselors to hit them.
What's the schedule?
That is the schedule of camps I know of going on that have either have permits in the past from planning board or are accompanied before us now. So this is just to keep in mind what's going on throughout the summer and which where at and what the loads are gonna kind of look like. You can see they start peaking more when you start getting into July. That's when most of them are going on, and then tail off in August.
Every week, you know, at the peak times, it still looks like we're looking at fairly low numbers, doesn't it?
Yeah, I mean, you're looking at right here in June, you got about 7 here. Here's one of your bigger.
Right, 25, 26, 27.
Yeah.
But those are campers, right? Those numbers?
These numbers? No, these are days.
Oh, that's the calendar day?
That's the calendar day.
Do we have the number of campers?
No, I don't have the number of campers for a lot of these here because I won't have them until they basically come through. Or I can look at the past permits for a lot of these, but you know, the camps we have tonight, we didn't get any numbers for them in the application, so I'll have to look at those. But that's something I want to bring forward in as we do this, is the number of campers. So you can look on here on the 18th how many cars you expect at these points.
Yeah.
So some of them happen on weekends?
Some of them run through weekends, yes. I don't know how you folks are doing it at Longfellow. I used basically your...
Ours is Monday through Friday.
Yeah. I used your calendar dates that you put in the letter, which is...
Yeah, Monday through Friday. We're Monday through Friday. We're not weekend. So like you said, we do run some tournaments there on weekends and sometimes a midweek after it camps out, but that doesn't require a permit. I mean, we may have a draw of 16, you know, that's spread out because I can only play 6 matches at a time. Yeah. You know, but that's not tied into the camp, though.
They're pretty well spread out. I mean, I just see 2. Brave Arts is a theatrical camp. and so there are only 2 at Regis that I can see at any given time. Oh, no, there's 3. The Gulin camp. We don't know what that is yet. But it's not, they're not all concentrated in one place. That's the thing.
Yeah. You got River School, Meadowbrook.
I mean, once we get on Wellesley Street, there's much traffic. I'm trying to get there from 23rd.
Yeah.
Regis has the most camps, but as you're right, it's 3.
Right. Okay.
helpful.
How many fewer students does Regis have during the summer? Probably doesn't come close to making up that.
I know.
Yeah. I mean, they've been running camps at Regis for, since I can remember. There's never been a traffic problem. If we're talking about 30 kids maximum.
Like I said, you won't get 30 cars because, yeah. Like I said, between us bringing a van, transporting probably 6 to 8 from the Concord area, the Concord North area, and then you got siblings. You know, if you did a car count on us, it'd be between 15 and 20 cars.
Yeah. For tournaments?
Yes.
What sort of attendance do you usually get?
You know, 16 people. I mean, that's all we can handle. You know, we'll play it over 2 nights or 2 days. So, you know, so if we do 16, so play, you know, round six, round four. So it'll be 4, 5, 30, and 7. So it's all spread out. It's all singles. They don't really do doubles tournaments anymore. Yeah.
It's really too bad they don't have any clay courts around here.
Yeah, it is.
Americans need to play on clay.
All private, we love to, because I'm not that clay.
They're hard to maintain.
It's a full-time job.
Yeah.
When I was youth organization, that's what I used to do. Maintain clay courts.
You were a coach at Rivers?
Yeah, I'm a boys varsity tennis coach. I just came back from a match. I was having a technical advisor. We played at Milton Academy, opened up the season today. We didn't go down there. It was a home match, but we don't have indoor backup. At Rivers and Milton, as soon as hockey season gets over, they get rid of the ice and put down the courts. Mm-hmm. So I don't have anything to do with the Rivers camp. I just,
yeah.
I'm the team director of Longfellow and I coach it.
Good. Any other questions?
That's good.
Okay. So I think we're good to go. We can. Take a look at the decision on what date
you might. You can do this one on the 20th as well.
20th of April. And do we want to set a term for this one?
They requested 5 years. That's been pretty typical of most of the cap permits.
Yeah, unless Regis builds more tennis courts. Yeah. It doesn't sound like the size is going to
change. I don't think they're kind of
it's the limiter. I think it is.
By the way, did you see that the logo gym is about the same time at Regis?
But that's basketball.
But the time is...
Oh, so you're going to get more cars at one time?
Yeah, I mean, it's half hour apart in the morning and 15 minutes in the afternoon, so maybe it's okay.
Yeah.
That's a potential.
Well, the rim, I forget what the population was for that camp. It's, I don't think it's... Boards of people.
Wasn't there a soccer or baseball camp last summer?
Yeah, but I don't think they're coming back. It doesn't look like they're coming back.
Soccer one, if you're talking about.
It's called Boston and something.
Yeah, now it's called like Global Premier Soccer, I believe. If you're talking about that one, it used to be called like Boston Premier Soccer.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they're not running one in Weston this year. At least that's from what I can tell on their website.
What is Boston Gulin?
It is basically an exchange camp with Chinese students that they come over with their parents. And so that is just kind of almost a cultural exchange. They have a lot of field trips in their calendar.
And they stay at Regis.
They stay at Regis escorting.
So let's move on to Longfellow tennis at the high school. Is it a similar program?
Similar program. I mean, we use it for our high school, pre-high school training again. It's what we do. Our thing that we use Weston High School for, be our high school camp. It's typically a little bit smaller. We have 4 courts at Weston High School. They do allow us. If no residents are there, we can take the other 2 courts provided we're aware that residents are there to use the courts. We do that just like if we get there in the morning when there's 3. This one would be another town if there's 3 groups playing, you let them finish up. Most of the time it's 3 by 9:30. where you start the camp on three courts. Or, you know, I don't think we've ever been in a place where all the courts have been used. If they did, we would have something to do with them just up on the track and before they finished up. They're through by now, pretty odd people play early in the summer. You know, it's a high school, pre-high school camp. It's, you know, a little bit smaller than our tournament camp. It's, as you know, if you have a teenager, it's not like it was when we were teenagers. They've always got something going on at other camp, riders at, they're working, et cetera. So, you know, I would say our average, you know, numbers there would be between 16 and 20. Typically, our high school campers, we don't allow, you know, they don't drop off. They drop off in Wayland, and then we drive them down to Weston or Native. We run a bus that leaves at Wayland, drops at Native, picks up at Native, and drops off at Regis, and then circles back and goes back up to Longfellow Lane.
Bus or van?
A van. 15 passenger van. So there we would have four or five instructors as well. You know, we have work, the guy that works my high school camp is the ski coach at Weston, and he's the one who's worked in the school, so for a year they put up a lot every year, hop in the van and go right into school.
Same hours.
Same hours. Same dates. Yeah, same dates. By the time we drop there, it's probably more like quarter after nine. Yeah. Just depends on that route traffic. And we snake through Route 27, School Street, Wayland, Oak Street, pick them up, and cut through Rivers, and, you know, we drop down from the high school. I don't know if it's Brown Street, but the street that comes down almost right, you know, right by Whiteland, and it goes down and drops right there at the high school, so I can stay off of Route 30.
Again, you could use the high school facilities if they have to go to the bathroom, that's right. What about rain days for these guys?
Same thing. We move them indoors. I mean, like I said, we only have 2.5 days. Our tournament camp is, you know, if I have like one of my busier weeks, we do have an arrangement with the Blue Racket Club where, you know, again, we have people that come from Lexington, Newton, whatever. And, you know, we'll meet there at Regis and you know, take them to Uber, or we'll have people that are Lexington who will just drop their kids at Uber, you know, Uber by usually 9:45. So.
Do you know what condition the Weston courts are in at the moment?
Yeah, they're good. They were resurfaced 2 to 3 years ago. And so they're in pretty good shape. They've been having an issue with people who put them in and they could come in and redo them. But yeah, they were redone 2 or 3 years ago, so they're in very good shape. And Regis's courts are brand new as well. They're, you know, less than 5 years old. Which is one of the reasons why we're contracting, because, you know, Sudbury and Wayland, we're using them as satellites if we have a problem, because they haven't touched their courts in 25 years. We've leased their courts for 25 years. And we run their parks and recreation programs, and we've put over $100,000 into them, and they've done no improvements on the tennis courts.
Mm.
And, you know, so now that, I don't want to say they're unplayable, but you know, we're not a super high-end camp. You know, if you look at us compared to, say, the Thoreau tennis camp and Harvard's tennis camp, we're less expensive. Even with that, and of course, they'll meet our standards. You know, our Day Cracking Club is the New England Academy of Tennis, and they lease courts from Brandeis, and they're licensed through Brandeis, so we have that camp run well, which is the super elite kids. You know, we've kind of got that middle tier kids, and then we've got the high school kids. And all they do is run the elite camp, and then I run the rest of the camps. A lot of people get confused with their camps, all of them. But they're good camps. So we had a lot of the Western kids that play on the high school team to work for us. Which is good. I'd say it's probably that, and those are the top two places where I hired kids to work at camp. Our recreation.
Good. Any questions, guys?
I'm good.
You're good? Okay.
Okay, so what are my next steps? Because this is, you know, those towns we just kind of
You don't have any next steps. What we'll do is we'll review decisions on both of these camps on April the 20th. Issued the decisions. I'm assuming this is also a five-year program.
Yeah, five-year request.
And you can be here when we review the decisions, or if you want to. No, we won't take testimony. We'll just review the decision, grant the permit. You're good to go.
So in the meantime, we can start working with the health department. We've got almost everything put together.
Yeah,
that's what I'm really looking for. So
right,
all the stuff for the health department.
The consensus here is that these camps look fine to us.
Yeah, like I said, with us, we usually go to the Board of Health and we fill out the permits and we get going. So it would like to just, that's our kind of our next steps to go. And if for some reason you don't do it, then we're on the road.
You're on the road. Okay. You'll have a permit by April the 20th from us. So
perfect.
You can go ahead with talking to Board of Health and
great. Should
be fine.
We've had some initial conversations. They said, wait till we have this meeting, and we kind of got part of the booklet put together because we've got a few booklets for other towns. So what they're looking for.
Yeah.
Thank
you. Okay. All right, thank you very much.
Appreciate it.
Good luck with it.
Okay. All right. So no rain.
I don't want you to jinx. You might, we're running really early, believe it or not. So are there any issues you'd like to discuss with us?
Yeah, why don't I give out what I started doing here now is this. Town planner's report, just kind of giving an update of where we are on kind of long-term issues, some upcoming meetings, other projects.
By the way, this is really helpful.
Good.
Yeah,
okay. Good.
Yeah. I could choose better colors.
But at least we get a comparison of what's going on.
That's very helpful.
So you could put in numbers, honestly. Just say the maximum kids and then add it up.
Yeah, I do want to do that. I take that point definitely. Yeah. And the only reason I couldn't do it is because I didn't have numbers for these camps, so
yeah,
I didn't start it. But
yeah, no, it's great.
But going forward with some of the other ones, I definitely want to do that.
So you can,
let's see. So just to kind of keep us abreast of some of the issues coming down, April 12th, we do have site visits scheduled for 660 Wellesley and 6 October Lane. Those are both RGFAs. April 12th is also a historical commission meeting for the Case Campus Review, and we're looking to make that a joint meeting. Or basically, that's just going to be a site plan review. Not actually a site plan review, because it's just going to be a review. We'll actually have to take on the specific scenic road portion of it, which is touching the wall, at a later meeting so that we can make notices.
So this is the first time I'm hearing about this 7 o'clock meeting.
This is the first
historical commission meeting.
Yeah.
So we're actually guests at the meeting. They're running the meeting. And the commission starts at 7.
Next meeting of the planning boards, April 20th and May 4th.
May 40B proposed, was that on Wellesley Street?
Yeah.
That's not the 660, or is that?
667.
Oh, that's not this
different site. Address.
Yeah, 667, yeah. So.
Okay, great.
I got confused by it too.
When are we planning to get input for 667 that's not on our agenda?
Not yet.
Okay,
no, I just got word of it today. So
okay, got it.
May 9th, as you know, is town meeting, and one thing I did want to check up with all of you is the July and August schedule. We don't have our meeting scheduled for them. I don't know what availability for all of you is at that time, but applications do keep coming in, so I want to be able to tell people when they can expect the next meetings.
We generally take August off.
August, oh yeah, that's what I.
Sometimes
you know, if there's a lot of, if there's a big backlog, what we try to avoid is piling up at the end of, you know, it, just before we leave. Mm-hmm. So I'm not sure what the frequency of and quantity of applications is right now, but sometimes last year we took, I think, the last week of July and all of August off.
That's okay.
It just depends on what's on the plate.
Yeah, right now I think we can handle. I have everything scheduled so that you would hear it on June 1st and do a decision on the 15th.
For June?
You know, however, that's as of today. It may, and that is assuming that those first ones, those items only take one hearing as well, only take one meeting to hear. There is a flex subdivision in there, so that may take, I don't know if that's gonna take longer than one hearing, but it's, they're not all necessarily slam dunks on that June day. But I have tried to keep it to there, but that's about, we're about maxed for June 1st and 15th right now.
So it may have to go over into July. It sounds as though you think that the schedule will go over into July, which is okay. I mean, we don't generally take 2 months off.
Okay.
Usually it's August.
Okay.
But, you know, July is kind of a flex month, so if it doesn't, if the applications aren't stacking up in July, and we could deal with them reasonably, and we don't get an onslaught in September, you know, if there's not a buildup anticipated in September, then,
okay,
you know, we just play it by ear
all right,
the latter part of July.
Okay. So if we were to do that, I imagine it's July 6th, right? But we won't set that in stone yet, but
yeah,
that's about what we're looking for. Okay.
What is this 1 in 5 Concord, dare I ask?
1 in 5 Concord is basically a... 1 in 5 Concord had a condition on them that they were not to advertise one of the lots for sale prior to completing their infrastructure, particularly the road, I believe.
They weren't to advertise any of the lots for sale.
The entirety of the parcel has been advertised on sale.
Well, not only that, but also the individual lots have also been advertised.
Yeah.
So they're in violation of the special permit. It have been for about a year.
Yeah, so what are you doing about it?
John is issuing a notice of violation to them. They are also coming in for, they are due for their extension. We've told them, basically just we're going to give them is we are not going to hear that extension request until they fix the violation. Is the first thing. And then when they come in for an extension, you know, it's all on the table for you folks again.
And 201 Newton Flex, didn't we already see that?
201 Newton Flex also has a violation. They have a road sign up that they're not supposed to have up, as I understand it. I have to do a little more follow-up on that one. I haven't gotten myself totally up to speed on that. But they also need approval of their CCNRs, or their homeowner's rules, from the folks who need to sign off on that. So that's another one we'd like them to get in order before we take any more action.
They're going to want site plan review, and we specifically said at the hearing that we would agree to the driveway changes, but not if they made it into a street, a named street, which they then probably turned around and made into a named street. So there's a bone of contention. That just needs to be ironed out. Namely, that it needs to revert back to a driveway.
What day is 55 Coburn coming in front of the...
55 Coburn I have on June 1st. I'm assuming that they, you know, they're fine on their intake date, but they're attempting to June 1st.
That's the flux you were talking about.
Yes.
I'm sure that will happen.
And he's already come before the preliminary.
Yes.
Okay.
So, Emi,
Susan Haber has told me that she'd be glad to talk to you also. You know, she was a planner here for many, many years, and just, you know, sort of chew the fat with you whenever it's convenient for you. She'd be glad to do that.
She's made that offer to me too, and I need to take her up on it.
Yeah.
There's actually a few specific things I am looking to discuss with her.
You will like her. So she's very sharp and easy to talk to.
As for our master plans, that we still have the housing production plan. Let me know that we're trying to schedule the meeting to approve it. That's still in a little bit of planning stages to do that. Case Campus Phase 4, like I said, we have that coming up both at Historic and for to review the scenic road. Case Estates has been contracted for design with Tom Worth. The rest of these are all Polaroid site and relocation of Kendall Green are all kind of ongoing, but there's nothing really concrete to discuss with them at this point. Rules and regulations update, I know that's a goal of the board, and you know, my intent is to, you know, by this or the next meeting, giving myself a little wiggle room is to have some kind of work plan for you folks on rules and regulations. I'm getting those updated. And then stormwater regulations and the MS4 permit, I bring that up because the stormwater workshop I went to yesterday, a lot of them focused on the new MS4 permit that's going to be coming down. And this was the first I learned of it, so I had to get up to speed on this really quickly. So,
what's an MS4 permit?
That's a stormwater permit that gives basically, you have to make a 5-year plan to bring your total maximum daily loads of discharge, particularly phosphorus, from into the Charles River Basin overall.
Oh, it's a state issue?
Yep. It's Mass DEP issue, so, and we have to bring those down. So we're part of that, so we have implementing actions. Those are mostly handled by DPW and...
Is this something new?
Stormwater Division. Actually, we've been under one. In effect for a while, but a new one is coming out.
Okay.
And so part of what was discussed yesterday, I don't know that we're going to see any of this, but some of the strategies that do occur, I don't know how typically, but that do occur in MS4 permits are changes to zoning regulations to look at, you know, how much open space. Fortunately, I think, you know, in Weston, we have a lot of open space to absorb stormwater and to absorb roots. And so, you know, from that end, we should be in good shape, but I don't know what's going to come out of that permit yet. But just to have a heads up, that's coming down the pipe. It's imminent. It was supposed to be out like 3 days ago, as I understand it, but isn't yet. So, camps, we just kind of went over. I wanted to present that to you folks and kind of get you an overview of what's going on in camps. Telecommunications facilities, I think it would be helpful to us also look at something like that.
Chart that tells us where they all are.
It tells you where they all are and the status of them. Yeah. And one of the things that I wanted to look at here is these are the caps going on. These are the folks who have expired but that appear to be operating this coming year. So I mean, I think those, you know, my plan is to reach out to these folks and let them know that with their operations, they should be coming in to renew their permit.
Good.
The same thing, you know, I plan to get a similar list to you folks for the telecommunications, for the mobile sites. And I will choose better colors if you want me to do it in better colors.
Yeah. But, you know, I'm just fine. So that, Northeast Chinese Youth Offices 2015 for expiration.
Yeah, so that Northeast, they are coming in though. We got an application for them. So they're New England Chinese, they have an application. I'm putting them on, I believe, on the 1st as well. So they're going to be in compliance.
Okay.
So.
Good. Wow, this is great.
So there's hey, a question on telecommunications, maybe, Alan. I've had people come up to me and say, can the town do anything about poor cell coverage here and there? And does the town ever take a proactive stance in requesting improvement on cell coverage and roads?
I have never seen it. My experience is no. I've always seen the town just kind of like accept them as they come.
Right.
I don't think, I usually, my opinion is any planning effort like that would be a good one, generally.
I mean, it would be serving the citizens.
Yeah. And I think, you know, again, a proactive approach of, I mean, one thing I like about, very much about the bylaw for, you know, or whatever they call it, personal wireless, personal telecommunications, is it names specific areas that you can do it in where it's, you know, allowed. I think, you know, revisiting those and what kind of coverage they give, there's definitely, the fellow who was here before asked me about just that same issue, and so I don't know if you folks are interested in doing something like that.
I'm actually communicating now with one of the selectmen. They're supposed to be getting back in touch with me.
About what?
I just can't recall about the poor coverage.
Oh, the poor coverage certain areas.
Yeah, we work with all the vendors, so we kind of want to sit down with him and.
It would be nice to have some proposals.
You don't remember which one? Was it Michael Harity? Was it Doug Gillespie?
I think it was Doug.
Okay.
I think it was Doug.
All right, good. That's interesting.
That's good news.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a good service to provide.
Yeah, so I'm supposed to be meeting with him hopefully next week, so.
Yeah.
Right.
Makes the road safe.
So yeah, we could do a mapping exercise relative to that and look at, you know, what kind of coverage there is, you know, look at, do we want to add some sites to that section of the bylaw to encourage them to go there? Yeah. So that's, you know, that's an effort we can undertake as well.
The sense that I have is that the law is very expansive in this way, because I think the state or the federal government has looked at telecommunications as a necessity.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so it's easy to see why it's the cell companies that are approaching and saying, here are the dark areas in town and here are the areas we'd like to provide coverage. And then in some ways it might be negotiation, but the idea is it's going to come one way or the other. How can we mitigate?
They look for the gap, is what they do. When they find the gap, that's when they go ahead and come in and they say, hey, we need to put a telecommunication facility here. But there's no reason why you can't work the other way. If you already have identified a gap, there's no reason why you can't put it out there and see what carrier would be willing to go ahead and come in and fix the problem. And that's what we need to talk to him about.
Another thought to you is that you handed this out, so it's a part of the meeting history. You have a meeting to approve the HPP. I think it should be more so a meeting to review the HPP. Approve is quite
something. Yeah, that's true. We're submitting it. It's not. We don't approve it. We're
reviewing it.
We agree to jointly agree with the selectmen to, at some point, to submit it to the state.
Good point. Good point. Okay.
And what is the Liberty Mutual Turnpike interchange note there? What's that flag for?
That's just to keep that on our radar for the special permit revision for access to the site. Bobby Show is reviewing that now. He should. I sent him the notice to proceed. He has the materials. He gave me, you know, I think it's about a 3 week or so timeline, so I should be hearing from him soon to get that in. I did also ask him to review Case Campus, so.
Good. And we're jointly meeting with the Historical Commission on the 12th. I imagine he won't be ready with any.
I doubt it by then, no.
What about the neighborhood meeting on the Warren Avenue?
Warren Avenue, we do need to schedule that, and that should be on here as an ongoing item. As I recall, we were looking to schedule that later in the year, more like around May or
May
so.
May, June, yeah.
May, June, okay.
But I think that's got to be, that's not an evening meeting, I think.
Okay.
And so, you know, it's going to have to, we may have to have it, think of having it maybe on a weekend day.
Okay.
When people can come, you know, who aren't committed to working, just so that we can have it be as flexible as possible.
Okay.
But I know the neighborhood has comments about you know, the report that Bob did a couple of years ago and how to resolve the bus turnaround issue. So we need to
touch that base.
Okay. Good. And then there are just two things on the other side of this.
Yeah. You just done that on a math test before. I only did the first thing when I handed it in, and the teacher laughed at me. She wouldn't give me the test back.
That's kind of mean to not give you the test back. So, April 27th, there is a concert, Mass Audubon has created a conservation mapping tool that they're going to be rolling out at a meeting in the morning. So I was planning on going to that. I think that could be, it sounds like, from what they told me, it does sound like a very, you know, interesting and effective tool. So I am interested in going and checking that out. And then you guys probably all know this, but there's going to be office hours for records and information.
Okay.
Here. So if there's anything you'd like me to bring up and go, let me know. If not, at least know what's going on.
Gotcha. Great. Thank you so much. This is very helpful.
When are we going to schedule July meetings? Did we schedule July meetings?
No, we don't quite know. What Imai was saying earlier, if I understand correctly, and I don't want to paraphrase you, but he's scheduled through June. We just don't know if there's going to be any slop over into July at this point.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So a couple weeks long, we've got to get training again.
Yeah.
Definitely. Okay, good. In that case, I think it's time for the hearing for T-Mobile at 487 Wellesley Street.
Good evening. My name is Ignacio Formoso. I'm with County Resource Management. I'm a site acquisition officer. I'm the agent for T-Mobile right now, representing them on behalf of the proposal that they're trying to do with the barn.
The barn meaning the
barn? I got the Andrew for it. I got lost. At 487 Wellesley Street.
The red barn.
The red barn. Peter and Julie Hyde are the owners, very nice people, and we currently have a site there now in one of the cupolas. Right there. If you're looking at the front of the building, at the front of the barn, the existing cupola is the one on the far right. That's the one that's currently being utilized. What they're proposing now is they want to add an additional two antennas to the cupola on the left. I don't know if any of you have been by that site, but I've been by there a few times, and you cannot tell. That is made out of fiberglass on the right-hand side. I literally sat with the owner there looking at it, and I could not see any imperfection. It looks identical to the rest of the structure. It looks identical to the other cupolas. And that's what they're intending to do now with that cupola on the left-hand side. The situation is they need to add three antennas to the site, and three are used, which are the remote radio heads. The antennas will not work without them. Everything is going to be internal. There will be nothing visible from the outside of the structure to where you can see any change whatsoever. If you see the photo set, it's the same before and the same after. And the reason being is that there is no change.
There are no cupolas being added, they're all existing.
The cupola's not being added. What's happening is this cupola is being replaced to match identical to the way it looks now with fiberglass material, the same as what they did with this cupola here. And that's what I was saying before. If you go to this site, you can't tell. There's an actual photo sim in the file there, which is an actual picture that I took at the site. And if you look at that picture, do you have that picture?
I have one of these here. I believe this is it, right?
Yeah, that's it. Yeah.
This is the existing one you did before, right?
Correct.
It's planned to do in the same way.
Do you have the far away, the one from the street?
I don't have the one from the street.
I have it right here. I have it.
Was that there originally that was rebuilt to look exactly the same, or is it a different?
This is a picture that I took from the street. Okay, and what you see here is on the blue is the existing, and the proposal is going to be this one. But the existing you can't tell that cupola has been redone. The paint matches perfectly. The structure is identical to the structure that was there before.
And that's what they're proposing to do again.
You're saying at that distance, you can't tell the difference?
I'm sorry?
At that distance, you can't tell the difference?
Even if you get right up close to it. And that's the God's honest truth. I was all over that property. I was out there with the owner. And he even pointed it out. He said that they did a fantastic job, and that's what we're hoping for again. The reason why they're adding the three antennas is that this particular site is a very low-lying site. There's not that much height on it, and the reason is that what they're doing with the site, they're primarily concentrating on I-90, yeah. On the I-90 corridor. And the demand is just getting greater and greater. And the data utilization is getting higher and higher.
And
the bandwidth is getting crazy.
Helpful.
Yeah, I think. Oh yeah, but it's not in color.
Yeah, I didn't get a color one.
Oh, sorry. Well, that's the color one there.
Why do they have to be fiberglass? Just curious.
For the antenna to be, for the signal to be able to go through it. I mean, it doesn't go through the wood. So they redoing the fiberglass. But like I said, if you're all ever out there, take a look at it, because I was amazed. I mean, I've seen where they've redone these and they try to match them, but you can always tell a little bit on this one, nothing. I mean, it's just very, very good, very, very good work. But that's basically what the site is there. So what they're doing is going to be adding three antennas. What they're going to do is they're going to add two antennas to the new one, and then they're going to add one additional one here, because this picture is a little bit bigger. So they currently have their three antennas in this one. They're going to put one antenna here, and they're going to put two antennas here, along with the remote radio heads that make the antennas work. The GPS is behind this cupola, and we do have to have on it. I remember speaking with you on the phone, I believe, about that, and I did find the GPS, remember that you questioned?
Yeah.
Yeah. And it was on the special permit from before.
Okay.
It was addressed on there, and it's also addressed on the reconstruction drawings that there will be, you know, it will remain behind that first cupola. We have to have there, we have to have that by federal law for the 911 calls, and to be able to identify the site when they're trying to triangulate, they're trying to find somebody, you know, where the call was made from, so that needs to be there. But again, that's not visible from the front in any way. But that's pretty much it. I mean, that's what they're shooting for.
What goes on in that barn?
Oh, I'll tell you.
Is it a house?
Have you ever been in there?
No.
I spent over an hour in that barn. If you go in that, it's like a time machine. Everything that's in there is from the 1800s. It's amazing. He's got old sleds. He's got horse tools, and he's actually got horses in the barn too. Him and his wife—they both work that barn by themselves. It's amazing. Yep.
The house is just to the right of the barn. Right.
Yes, it's over. Yeah, it's over here. But I lost my time in that barn. I was just in there an hour. I even said I'm going to bring my wife back here, because I was just in shock with everything. It looks like you're going back in time. It's just amazing.
Yeah.
Really nice people.
Yeah.
Really nice people.
So I assume that, you know, you're under the RF standards and all of that.
Absolutely, sir. Everything's included in the packet. I have the, I put the radio frequency affidavit in here. I have the SEC license, the listing street photo, the construction drawings, the owner authorization, and of course the application for it. The whole packet is complete.
Okay. Is there any comment from the audience? I see two people here. No? Just here for the heck of it, huh?
Matt's on another business here. one final item of other business we have to take.
Oh, okay, other business, okay.
These guys look like the ones that use the cell phones.
Power supply to those radios? And where's those through a conduit underneath?
No, it runs.
Water wheel. Everything's all time in the barn, right? So it runs, water wheel.
Everything runs inside the barn, and then they have what is known as an equipment room. It's a small area, 10 by 10 space,
yep.
Where they have actually all the software, and they have the actual hardware components there. But on the top is primarily just the antennas and the radio heads. Because the closer the radio heads are to the antenna, the quicker the information moves. So they try to keep the radio heads real close to the antennas. But everything else is on the bottom in the equipment room, 10 by 10 space, and it's in the barn. I mean, you don't even see it when I went in there. It's confined off. It's secure. It's in one area of the barn. You know, and then they run everything through conduit from the cupolas down to the equipment room. And that's pretty much it. Everything. So, like I said, it's a low site because they're just addressing a certain area. They don't need the height. So that's why that was a perfect location. I mean, he's literally right next to I-90. Couldn't have asked for anything better.
And the income helps them take care of this.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, that's a lot of upkeep. I just can't believe that those two individuals can do what they do. It's a lot of work. They have at least 3-4 horses there that they take care of, too. So they're busy from morning till night.
Sounds good.
Any other questions or comments? Good. In that case, I think we're all set. We'll issue the decision.
I think this one we can do on 4/22.
On April the 20th. Is this on a schedule? Is this on a renewal schedule? You know,
I have it right here. According to this, I think it's every 5 years.
Right.
When is it? Started back in 2006.
When is it up?
I think this one has actually expired.
We need to renew the permit. So we'll also do that in the decision.
Oh, okay. Great.
Okay.
All right, and I'll be following up shortly, like I said, hopefully next week.
Okay.
With the other issue. So
great, thanks.
Well, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Nice.
Good night. Bye bye. Oh, do you want these?
Sure, I'll take them.
Okay.
Sure. They're on file too, so
okay.
Thank you. Very nice meeting all of you.
Okay, other business?
I do have one other business.
Oh, what is the other
business? This is a 432 Concord. Sue and I made a site visit out there. They are proposing to relocate a garden and, what was it, add a shed?
So,
yeah, you want to bring
up? Do you have the plan?
I do, I have that too, and I'll put that up, but so also.
Same thing, but I just keep it garden design.
So yeah,
this was under a previous RGFA. We had a 10x10 shed and just a garden space. And again, what you're seeing is the old approved plan, and the shed and the garden were part of that. The clients would actually like to push it. It's about behind the house. We are the footprint on the approved plan was 10x10. We'd like to enlarge the footprint of the shed slightly, so it's 10x16 as opposed to 10x10. The new location, though, is more out of sight than it was previously. The house is actually kind of shielding it. It's now further back from the main road, kind of in a pocket. The grade rises up on this side. And the garden is also being reduced as well. We're keeping about the same amount of impervious paving, keeping that from 90 to 80.
So Sue and Kim both made a site visit and believe this is a minor change.
Yeah. That's what Sue was saying last time. I'm just so I'm clear.
Mm-hmm.
What is it that you're proposing to modify? I'm not exactly sure.
So the main modification is the size of the shed. So
size
and the location.
And the location.
So the red is the previously approved.
Yeah.
It's shown on both on the what's on the screen as well. The green is what we're proposing. So the red's going away.
Okay.
And the green is what is actually what we'd like to have.
Okay.
So it's basically taking the previous program and just moving it.
Okay. It's slightly larger.
The shed is slightly larger. The garden is significantly.
But you're planting a couple of additional screen trees. I guess it's for the. There's a path there, right?
So the path was relocated as part of
right.
the old.
Yep.
So that's already been.
Right, I understand. But I assume the screen trees are to screen the shed from the
yes.
from the path. And what are they?
Those are actually part of the proposed old planting.
Okay.
They're in the current location of the shed.
Okay.
And there's actually, it's kind of a low point, but basically the lawn is kind of sunk there. So the water's pouring anyway, so they're not doing that great. So we're just going to move them
slightly. Move them over?
Yeah.
That's okay.
better location slightly higher.
And the gray is the garden itself?
Yes, correct.
And so it's getting much smaller?
Yes.
And is Concord Road on the right?
Concord Road is running.
Yeah.
Right. Right.
And this is an existing house?
Yes.
Yeah.
Basically...
Are you the owner?
No.
No. Oh, no.
He's scared to hang out.
He's also
Oh, okay. All right.
And this is basically the last component of this plan that hasn't been implemented.
Sue Zechariah said that we should go and see this. She said this is just outstanding.
It is a good
She says it touches all the bases that we try to communicate to people about fitting the design into the landscape, and, minimizing impacts. And, so she was really blown away by this, by how this came out.
This is 432 Concord?
Yes, that's correct.
I don't think that's the road there.
No, this is about five years ago, maybe, something like that, four or five years ago.
I'm sorry, the Concord Road's right here.
Okay, can you just kind
of... Yeah, of course. Yeah, so the shed would be going right at the corner of that existing square.
Okay.
So the drive comes like that.
Yeah.
So this is the drive you're seeing.
Right.
It's screened by...
Away, it looks like. At least a property and a half away.
It's screened by most of the trees.
Yeah, right.
I think it's a little...
Yeah,
hard to rectify them just because I think that the house kind of dominates the image, so your proportions are bits.
Mm-hmm. Just out of curiosity, what are the dates on the drawing? I'm trying to remember how long.
So that's a great question. So this is back in 2012. The last
This was one of Kim's first projects working with the board. So, anybody have a problem with the proposed change?
No, sounds good.
Steve, what do you think?
I think it's fine. So it's going where there are six trees right now.
There's three plantings. Or I should say they're not. One of them's a witch hazel. One of them's a ornamental furnace of some type that the client planted. The other one's a fir. They were all part of this plan and were planted. So they're not, they're part of the plantings that went along with this plan. So they're not pre-existing trees that were moving. All of that's, we're staying inside of the existing metaphors that we set to actually protect those existing trees. Pre-existing.
Right.
So what is the net change to the total tree count?
It's the same.
Zero.
So the only, just to be clear, the only plantings we're modifying are those that the clients have planted themselves.
So does that answer the question, Steve?
Sure.
So is everybody all right with this change?
Mm-hmm.
They will modify the decision,
issue a memo
that says this is okay. Change is okay.
Mm-hmm.
And that's that.
All right.
Thanks
so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
If you can give me a short copy too.
Yes.
Do we have any other business?
Street view, nope, that's not
here.
Right.
Anybody move to adjourn?
So who?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Sorry. Nice shot, guys.
This one was, I didn't know. I thought you'd come down.